Hi students, in this lecture we are going to study some possible multiple choice questions on EC 8352 signals and system. Let us enter into the session. Totally in this unit we have, in this subject we have 5 units. So here I will give you some possible multiple choice question. It will cover all the 5 units in this subject. Let's enter into the session. First question: the type of systems which are characterized by input and output quantized at certain level are called as dash. Once I repeat the question, the type of systems which are characterized by input and the output quantized at certain levels are called as: option A, analog; option B, discrete; option C, continuous; option D, digital. Yes, of course, your answer will be discrete, because here discrete systems have their input and output values restricted to enter some quantized levels or discretized levels. Am I clear? So discrete signal only have quantized level and or otherwise called discretized level. So the answer will be discrete. So next question: the type of systems which are characterized by the input and output capable of taking any values in a particular set of values. See, when compared to the previous question, so here in the previous question we have the input and the outputs are quantized at a certain level. Okay, quantized at a certain levels means definitely it will goes to under the category of discrete category. But here in this question, the input and output capable of taking any values, or any values. Continuous means the signal it will define for any value of any value of time. That is we call it is continuous. So this question's answer will be definitely continuous. Okay. So here the option A is analog, option B is discrete, option C is digital, option D is continuous. So your answer will be continuous. Explanation. Look at this explanation. Here the continuous systems have restriction on the basis of the upper bound and lower bound, but within this set the input and output can assume any value. Your input and output can assume any value, thus they are infinite values attainable in this system. We call it as continuous system. This is the function of continuous sign system. So this is also sometimes it will be asking under the 2 more question. Okay, so this note down this explanation. So the this two explanation is it tells about the basics of signals, continuous time signals and discrete time, continuous time system and discrete time system, right? So third problem: a system which is linear is said to be obey the rules of dash. Okay, so option A is scaling, option B is additivity, option C is both scaling as well as additivity, and D is homogeneity. Yes, of course, because when the system is said to be linear, if it is obey the superposition principle, we call it as linear. Okay, so in the superposition principle, it will satisfy both scaling property as well as additivity property. So the answer is C. See, a system is said to be additive and scalable in order to classify it as a linear system. Okay, so it obeys the additivity property and scaling property. So option C is the correct answer. Next question: a time invariant system is a system whose output, option A is it increases with a delay element, option B is it decreases with the delay element, option C is it remains same with a delay in input, option D is it vanishes with a delay in input. Okay, linear time invariant system. Okay, time invariant system means if the input and output characteristics do not change with respect to time, that is we call it as time invariant. So here the answer will be it increases with the delay in input. it decreases with the delay in input. It remains same with the delay in input. It vanishes with the delay in input. Okay, let us see what is the correct answer. So option C is the correct answer, because a time invariant system's output should be directly related to the time output. Okay, so there should be no scaling here, because it is directly related to time output. Here the scaling operation is not possible. So for example, y of t equal to function of x of t. So here it remains same with the delay in input. It remains same with the delay in input. So option C is the correct answer. Next question. A system is said to be defined as non-causal. Then option A, here the output at the present depends on the input at an earlier time. Option B, the output at the present does not depend on the factor of time at all. Option C, the output at the present depends on the input at the current time. Option D, the output at present depends on the input at a time instant in the future. So which one will be correct when the system is said to be defined as non-causal? Yeah, option D is the correct answer, because a non-causal system's output is said to be depends on the input at a time in the future. So that is non-causal. Okay, so here the output at the present depends on the input at a time instance in the future. We call it as non-causal. Okay, so if any one of the output is depend upon future means, we call it as non-causal. Am I clear? Right. So here, sixth question. Amplifiers, motors, filters, etc. So these are some examples that will be given here. Amplifiers, motors, and filters are the example for which type of system? Okay, so first one, distributed parameter system. Option B, unstable system. Option C, discrete time system. Option D, continuous time system. So amplifier, motors, filters, they are definitely, this is the example for continuous time systems. I will give you the explanation why it is comes under continuous time. Because amplifier, motor, filter, these are the example for continuous time system. As the system operates on a continuous time input signal and it produces a continuous time output signal. This is the main reason. Whereas discrete time systems operates on discrete time signal, and the distributed parameter system, parameter systems have signals which are the function of space as well as time. And unstable system, it produces unbounded output from bounded or unbounded input. Okay, so amplifier, motor, filters, any kind of filters, okay, any kind of amplifier, and definitely these are all comes under the continuous time system only. Okay, next question. Which one of the following system is causal? Option A, y of t equal to x of t plus x of t minus 3 plus x of t square. This is t square. Option B is y of n equal to x of n plus 2. Option C, y of t equal to x of t minus 1 plus x of t minus 2. Option D, y of n equal to x of 2n square. Okay, 2n square, this is square. So answer will be C. Okay, let us check how it is comes C. Because a causal system is one which the output depends on present value as well as past value, but not future. This is the condition. Yeah, as I said earlier, in previous question itself, you understood about what is causal and what is non-causal, isn't it? If causal means if your output is depend upon present value as well as past value is causal. Non-causal means if any one of the output is depend upon future, we call it as non-causal. Okay, so here given system is causal, isn't it? So if it depends on the future values, that is non-causal. For example, if y of t equal to x of t minus 3 plus x of t square. Okay, first choice. Let us take the first one. And second one, y of n equal to x of n plus 2. And third one, y of n equal to x of 2n square. That is D. So this question and all here, the output is depends on future value. Okay, because when t equal to 0, we substitute here t equal to 0. Right, I may show you here. Okay. Suppose I substitute here when t equal to 0 in this question. So it becomes 0. So So here 0, here also x of 0, here also x of minus 3, here it became x of t square, no? So 0. So it is, your output is depend upon present as well as past. Am I clear? Present as well as past. So definitely this question is goes for causal system. Okay, present and past, each one of the following system is causal, right? Second one, y of n equal to x of n plus 2. So here also, when you substitute here 0, it becomes 2, future. So this given system is not causal. This is non-causal. And third one, here, y of 0, it becomes x of 2n square. So 0. When you substitute here 1, it becomes 2 into 1 square, it becomes 2. When you substitute 2, 2 into 2 square, that is, it becomes 8. So your output is dependent upon future input. So this goes for non-causal. Next, this is one. When t equals 0, it becomes y of 0. Third option, let's check the third option. So which is equal to x of minus 1 plus x of minus 2. When you substitute some positive value, higher value. Okay, when t equal to 2, what do you get? So y of 2, which is equal to x of 2 minus 1, 1, plus x of 2 minus 2, 0. Okay, so here your present input is 2, but it is your output is depend upon as that is previous value. So here your output is depend upon previous value, so past value. So your, if it is depend upon your output is depend on present as well as past, means the given system is said to be causal. So option C is the correct one. Okay, for example, here in this problem, first one, when t equal to, I substitute here t equal to, okay, what do you get? T equal to, here when I substitute here t equal to, for this A, let us check A, y of 2, which is equal to x of 2 plus x of 2 minus 3 is minus 1 plus x of t square, that is 4. So here your output is depend upon present input, past input, as well as future also. If anyone of the output is depend upon future, definitely the system is said to be non-causal. So this is not causal. Now I may clear you for you. Okay, so option C is the correct answer. So option C. Okay, next move on to another session. I'll erase it, all this content. Wait, just a moment, mate. The system, it produces a zero output for one input. Zero output for one input. And same gives the same output for several other inputs. So what is the system called? Am I clear? So first, a system, it will produce a zero output for one input. And same gives the same output for several other inputs. So what is the system called? Option A, non-invertible system. Option B, invertible system. Option C, non-causal system. Option D, causal system. So answer will be non-invertible system, because here the system is said to be invertible. Invertible means the input fit to the system, it can be retrieved from the output of the system. Okay, otherwise the system is non-invertible. So this is invertible. So invertible means, suppose if your input is fed to the system, it can be retrieved from the output of the system. Okay, so also if the system gives zero output for any input, and it gives the same output for many inputs, whatever inputs you are given, the same output will be produced. So then the system is said to be non-invertible. So the option A is the correct one. Am I clear? I hope you understood this question. Next question. Discrete time signals is derived from continuous time signals. Yeah, of course. Any discrete time signal, it is derived from continuous time only. But here in this question, they are asking what process? Addition process or multiplying process or sampling process or addition and multiplication process. As of course, you all know about this one. Okay, your discrete time signal is absent from continuous time. How it will happen? By using a sampling process, isn't it? So sampling is the correct answer, because sampling is the process wherein continuous time signal is converted into discrete time signal. Okay, this is the main reason for conversion of continuous to discrete. Next question. Energy signal has zero average power and power signal has zero energy. This statement is true or false? Okay, explanation. Energy and power signals are mutually exclusive one. Okay, energy signal has zero average power, power signal has infinite energy. Am I clear? But in this question, energy signals are zero average power. First case is true only. But power signal has not zero energy. It is infinite energy. So here they make a mistake. So your answer will be false. Next, the time period of continuous time sinusoidal signal is given by dash. Time period. T which is equal to 2 pi by omega. Option B, T equal to 2 pi by 3 omega. Option C, T equal to pi by omega. Option D, T equal to pi by 2 omega. So which one will be correct here? Option A is the correct one. Isn't it? Because x of t equal to a cos of omega t plus pi is a continuous time sinusoidal signal. Yeah, this is the continuous time signal. Let us take the example, this one. Okay. And its period is given by t equal to 2 pi by omega, because omega which is equal to 2 pi f, f equal to 1 by t. Okay. See, I'll show here. Omega which is equal to 2 pi f. So here f equal to 1 by t. So 2 pi by t. Okay. Therefore t equal to, okay, therefore t equal to 2 pi by omega. This is the correct one. 2 pi by omega. Am I clear? Right. So the answer A is the correct one. So second, next question, if x of n equal to 2 times cos of 2n, 2 times cos of 2n, so is periodic or not? Is periodic or not? Yeah, option A is periodic with period 2n, option B is periodic with period 2 pi, option C is periodic with period 2, and option D is non-periodic. Let us discuss the answer. X of n is equal to 2 times cos 2n, no? So here the given signal is non-periodic only, because it doesn't satisfy the equation omega equal 2 pi m by n, because where n is the fundamental period and m is an integer. Okay, so our problem is doesn't satisfy this condition, so the given signal is said to be non-periodic. Okay, omega equal to 2 pi by m, so the given signal is said to be non-periodic, right? Because here omega n which is equal to 2, answer will be 2, right? But here the ratio is not equal. Okay, it's not satisfied for periodic condition, so the given signal is said to be non-periodic one. Next one is, convolution is used to find, first option, impulse of an LTA system, frequency response of an LTA system, then option C, time response of an LTA system, option D, phase response of an LTA system. Let us discuss the answer. Option C is the correct one, because convolution is used to find time response of an LTA system. When you are asking about the convolution, what is the purpose of convolution means? The purpose of convolution is used to analyze the time response of an LTA system. Okay, because we know the time response of an LTA system. Formula will be y of n equal to summation k, infinite k, which is equal to summation x of k, h of n minus k. So here it can be written as y of n equal to x of n star h of n. This is the convolution operation, right? Convolution of two system. So therefore convolution is used to find the time response of an LTA system only. Okay, x of k, that is summation h of k, x of k, h of n minus k. Here you put summation, not infinite. Here you put summation. Next question, the Fourier transform of rectangular function is, already we solved one problems also, isn't it? In system or problem part B questions, we will discuss about this rectangular function formula problem also by applying the Fourier transform. Okay, from the question you can able to answer this question. Okay, option A is another rectangular pulse, option B is triangular pulse, option C is sine C function, option D is impulse. Okay, so Fourier transform rectangular function is sine C function only it will be produced. Okay, because substituting the square pulse function f of t in the below equation f of j omega equal to integral f of t, that is summation f of t e to the power of j omega t into dt, so this will be given as a sin c function. See here it will be mistake here, I'll be rewrite here f of j omega which is equal to integral minus infinite to plus infinite. The infinite will be coming here. Okay, function is f of t e to the power of j omega t with respect to dt, so I put here dt. Okay, this is the correct one, Fourier transform definition. So dt will produce the output is sine c function. So it's not a rectangular function, it's not produced triangular function, it's not produced impulse function, it will produce the sine c function. So option C is the correct answer. Next let us move into the next question. The property of Fourier transform which starts the compression in time domain is equivalent to expansion in frequency domain. So which one will be the answer? Option A is duality will be given, scaling will be given, time scaling will be given, frequency shifting will be given. So among the possible answer, which one is correct will be for this question? Option B is the correct one, scaling property, because we know the definition of Fourier transform. So Fourier transform means is the functions derived from the given function and it is representing it by series of sinusoidal function. Okay, Fourier transform it will represent in terms of series of sinusoidal function. So the property of Fourier transform which states that compression in time domain is equal to expansion in frequency domain, that is we call it a scaling. So scaling means when you compress the time domain, what will happen, it will produce or expansion in frequency domain, that is f equal to 1 by t. When time period is reduced, your frequencies get increased. So that is the concept, that is what scaling. So scaling can be found by putting the value of pulse function in the definition of Fourier transform. So for this question, scaling is the suitable one answer. The property of Fourier transform satisfy compression in time, expansion frequency. Yeah, compression in time, expansion in frequency, it is obtained from only the scaling only, right? So next question, the function which has its Fourier transform, Laplace transform, and is a transform unity, is dash. Option A Gaussian, option B impulse, option C sine C, option D pulse. So answer will be impulse, because I'll give you the explanation here. The definition of Fourier transform is integral minus infinite to infinite. See here, there will be mistake, this limit will be coming here. That is integral minus infinite to plus infinite f of x e to the power of j 2 pi jx f into with respect to dx. So once I write the definition here, if you get confusion you just listen here. So integral minus infinite to infinite f of x e to the power of j 2 pi x 2 pi f into x, 2 pi f into x, that is omega value with respect to x, so I put here dx. So this is a definition of Fourier transform. So the definition of Laplace transform is integral minus infinity infinite f of t. This is definition of Fourier transform. Laplace transform is which is equal to same formula, integral minus infinite to infinite bilateral transform. So here I put here f of t, for a difference I will show here, e to the power of minus st into dt. First one is Fourier transform definition. Second one is Laplace transform. And third one is Z transform. For Z transform, you will take down summation. Fourier one day, Laplace only, it will come at a continuous time. But Z transform is applicable for discrete time. Okay, so here n varies between minus infinite to plus infinite. X of n is at power minus a. Okay, so first one is definition of Fourier transform, second one is definition of Laplace transform, and third one will be definition of Z transform. Okay, now I substituting the function of f of t equal del of t in this definition of Fourier, Laplace and Z transform. So instead of f of t, I substitute here del of t. So we get the transform in each case as 1 only. Your answer became 1. So hence the impulse function has unity Fourier, Laplace and Z transform. Okay, for impulse function only, when whatever transform you applied for impulse function, the answer became 1. Okay, answer became 1. Okay, keep in your mind, whatever transform you applied for impulse function, you will get the answer will be 1. So the answer is here impulse function. Okay, in this question the answer is impulse 1. Am I clear? So next question, the Fourier transform of a Gaussian pulse, the Fourier transform of Gaussian pulse is also called as Gaussian pulse. Previous question, the Fourier transform of impulse function is said to be unity. So here in this function case, the Fourier transform of Gaussian pulse is also a Gaussian, right? It means true or false. So option A, true. It is a true only because Gaussian pulse is x of t equal to e power minus pi t square. Okay, e power minus pi t square. So Fourier transform x of f is the same only will come in here, isn't it? E to the power of minus 2 pi f. So hence the Fourier transform of Gaussian pulse is also known as Gaussian pulse only, right? Generally Gaussian pulse function is e to the power of minus 2 pi t, whereas Fourier transform it became 2 pi f. That is the difference. So both are same only, so true only. Hence the Laplace transform, find the Laplace transform del of t. Yeah, as I said earlier, no, Laplace transform del of t is 1, Fourier transform del of t is 1, Z transform del of t is also 1. So the answer is 1. So next question, which of the following is the process of aliasing? Okay, option A, peak up overlapping. Option B, phase overlapping. Then option 6, amplitude overlapping. Option D, spectral overlapping. Okay, aliasing. So aliasing means spectral overlapping, because aliasing is defined as the phenomena in which high frequency component is in frequency spectrum of the signal. It takes the identity of a lower frequency component in the spectrum of sampled signal. Okay, so aliasing can occur if either the following condition it will exist. One is the signal is not band limited to finite range. That is the first case. When the aliasing it will occur means the signal is not band limited to finite range. And second thing is the sampling rate is too low. So aliasing means the superimposition of high frequency component and lower frequency component. We call it as aliasing. Okay, so which one is here overlapping? Spectral overlapping, not peaks or not phase or not amplitude. Okay, only the spectral overlapping. Option D is the correct answer. Next, 20th question. Find the Nyquist rate and Nyquist interval for the signal f of t equal to rectangular of 200 t, 200 times t. Okay, you have to find the Nyquist rate as well as Nyquist interval. Right, let us discuss here. Options will be given. F of t, given f of t is rectangular pulse of 200 t. So which is nothing but rectangular pulse signal. Okay, rectangular, R-E-C-T, it means rectangular. So rectangular pulse signal will be given. So having the pulse width, so pulse width is 1 by 200 sin. Here, frequency will be given now. So how to find the time period? 1 by f. So 1 by t, so 1 by 200 seconds will be given. So pulse will be given, pulse width is 1 by 200. Since the signal is finite duration signal, it is not band limited. So the signal spectrum consists of infinite frequency. So the answer will be Nyquist rate is infinite. Nyquist interval is 0. Okay, Nyquist rate f of which is equal to infinite. So infinite hertz. First option is infinite hertz. interval time period 1 by infinite 1 by 1 by 0 it comes to 0 so Nyquist interval is 0 so infinite hertz and 0 second option A is the correct answer okay so option A is the correct answer because since your signal is finite duration signal but it is not band limited so the spectrum is consist of infinite frequency only okay next question so within this I concluded my first part of video okay in next part I will be posting next set of possible set of multiple choice questions comes under the signals and system okay thank you students thank you for watching this video thank you